Good morning, everyone, and I welcome you to the sixth meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee. I've received apologies from Patrick Harvey, who is unable to attend today, and I know that James Kelly will join us during the proceedings this morning. Can I remind everyone just to either switch their mobile phones off or at least put them into a mode that won't disturb the proceedings? Agenda item one relates to whether the committee agrees to take agenda item three in private. And ask members to agree to take agenda item three in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Item two on our agenda today is to continue to take evidence as part of our inquiry into the first year of operation of the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax. And today we'll hear from Karen Campbell from Homes from Scotland, Jonathan Gordon of the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, David Melhuish. Got that one right, I hope?
Yes.
Good. Of the Scottish Property Federation and Professor Mark Stevens of Heriot Watt University. Now, obviously, I very much warmly welcome our witnesses to our proceedings this morning. Members will have received copies of the written submissions put in by the panel members today, together with a paper from the clerks. We'll go straight to questions, but can I say to the panel members, if there might be a specific question to a specific person, but if you feel free to contribute to that question area if you wish. And with that, I would ask Ivan McKee if he would begin the discussions this morning.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Thanks very much for coming along today. The first area I want to kind of explore was round about the impact of the change to LBTT on the overall Scottish Government's tax take. Now, I've been hunting through these numbers and I'm failing to find any evidence, and you can maybe help me with that. Certainly, if you look at the total tax take for residential properties, £270 million in the last year of stamp duty, then dipped to £202, which is what you'd expect as part of the forestalling effect. But then if you look at the first 4 months where we are in 2016-17, it's back at an annualised run rate of over £280 million. And if you look at that broken down by the quarter, you see that trend, you see a hit in that first quarter after the change to LBTT as a result of the forestalling, and then it recovers quite quickly. Similarly, if you look at the high-value properties over £1 million, you see a huge number clustered into that right at the end of that financial year, and then a dip, obviously, for a few months. But by now, 16, 17 months after the change, it's fully recovered back to where it was before. I know there was some from the Scottish Property Federation. You kind of alluded to there may be a change, but again, when I look at the number of transactions in that 325 to 750 range, the number of transactions is up now compared to 2 years ago. It's very difficult to see the numbers from your chart. But if you take effect with the forestalling effect in there between 2014-15 and 15-16, I don't really see any evidence for any tail off as a result of the changes. Do you want to comment on any of that?
Yes, I suppose as you referred to it, quite happy to refer to that. So quite a few questions in that. So I think the first thing I'd say is in terms of the tax take you referred to for 16-17, just a point to make there. I think the overall figures, when you see the headline overall figures from Revenue Scotland, they for residential, they will include the additional dwelling supplement, which I think has boosted it considerably to date, I think. And also, I mean, there is a separate column which strips that out, so you can actually take the residential figure and
do you have a value for that?
Reduce that. I think you're up to... I think you're... over 16 million, I think, is...
16 in which period?
Out of... this was... I think this was up to the end of June, so it might not include July's, but at that stage, there was 65.5 million of residential. This is for 2016-17, so this financial
correct.
Year.
That's correct, yeah.
Yeah.
The first 3 months was 64.5, yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But as I say, ADS was actually quite a significant slice of that. What we don't know at the moment is how much of that should be repaid. I think there's an 18-month period where some of it might be reclaimed by the taxpayer. I don't have a handle on how greater proportion that might be by now, but I think maybe just to make the point that the 3% additional supplement is
how much
making
of,
a significant
so clearly
change.
So the issue about that is how much of that, what was the run rate on that before, and is this run rate significantly more? Because what you've expected on ADS is a forestalling effect to hit you in the previous quarter,
yeah,
the January to March quarter, and then a dip in
yeah
this quarter.
Yeah.
So have you got any estimate of how much of that might be due to that forestalling effect?
I think the best estimate I've seen, I think the Fiscal Commission came out with one of around about 7 million, I think.
Okay.
So, I mean, just to turn on to the, perhaps the precise, I mean, for the £1 million plus houses, I think our take on it is that there was, I think, a dip after a period, as you reported, but then later in the financial year, that market recovered and seemed to get going now, and I think was again moving along as round roughly expected by the end of that year. The 325 to 750 range, I do think there was a change between 14-15, the last year of SDLT, and 15-16. And I think, again, I think that is on the table we provided. I think we suggested there was a reduction in the number of transactions there, and again I think the Commission were estimating a fall off in forecast revenue in that area of around about 35 million in their own report. So I think, I mean, for us,
who estimated that?
I think the Fiscal Commission
right
did in their outturn.
Is that against forecast?
Yes.
Right, because of course, I mean, you really got to compare it against previous years because the forecast was revised upwards,
yeah,
and they failed to meet it. So for a true comparison,
yes,
you really look
yeah
at previous years,
yeah,
which you don't really see any drop-off at all. And I mean, just looking at your chart, 325 to 750, Q1 2016, 1991 transactions, so annualised almost 8,000, which is actually more than any of the previous years.
Yeah, that's the 250 to 325.
325 to 750, 1991 transactions, 2016 Q1. That's on page 4, bottom of page 4.
So this is the table you're referring to?
Yeah, table at the bottom of page 4.
Yeah. So 2014 to 15, 325001 to 750, you've got 7555.
That's right, yeah.
And then it... So then that goes down to the first year of LBTT to
yeah
7390.
Which is a forestalling effect, yeah.
Yeah, so...
And then on Q1, it's back up to almost 2,000, which is 8,000 annualised.
So, well, I mean, if you annualise that figure,
yeah,
obviously we've got to see it.
Sure. But the point I'm making is there's yeah absolutely no evidence that says there's any yeah any hit on transactions or
yeah
revenue.
I mean, I think our point in that was just a straightforward number for number compared to the year during the last year of SDLT within that price range compared to the first full year of SDLT. I think there's a lower number of transactions.
Yeah, there's 165 lower transactions, which
yeah
is about 2-3%, but that's minimal if you
compare
the effective forestalling impact.
Yeah, I mean, what I would say in that is if you look at the trend, you will see a significant increase recovering from the recession going onwards, but then all of a sudden you see that change, as we're suggesting, a drop-off in actual number of 160-odd transactions. So what I'm saying is I can't think of any other reason.
Well, forestalling.
Yeah, but if the trend was like that, and then even with forestalling, if it stayed at that level...
Sure, but it's no...
What
back
I'm saying
up
is I think the tax did have...
Well, again,
I
can't see any evidence for that based on those numbers, because what's happened is there's been a 2 or 3% drop-off, which is less than I would have expected for forestalling, if you think about the amount of money involved and how easy it is to move things a week or two.
Yeah.
So there's no evidence there, and now we're back at a run rate that's higher, significantly higher than it was if you look back over the last year or the year before. So I think it's difficult to argue there's been any downturn. Now, you might say it should have been growing much faster,
yeah,
right? But I think that's I don't see the evidence that says that there's been any hit at all in terms of what's... What's happened there with those numbers?
Well, I mean, I think we'd probably stand by a line that there was significant increases in activity between those bands, and it then stalled, for want of a better phrase. And I can only see that the change in tax and the change in the rates and thresholds above 325.
And again, I come back.
I think that impacted on that.
The numbers don't say that. The numbers say that it's continued to increase.
I disagree.
Well, 1991 annualised is a bigger number than 7390. It's a bigger number than 7555.
But okay. I mean, that's to say that's the first quarter of this year. Okay. So
can I just interrupt just for a second till I get some clarity around this? Can I wee bit, just so I understand, first of all, the table at the bottom of page 4 in the Scottish Property Federation's submission, is that your own table or is that a table you've taken from somewhere? Is that the...
That's from Registers of Scotland.
That's from Registers of Scotland. Well, what I don't understand in that case, forgive me, folks, is how that compares with the table that's in the papers that we've been provided with today. Because the figures that have been provided today from Registers of Scotland would suggest a different picture to what that's saying, not in money terms, but in terms of number of transactions. Because if I've got this right, do you have that table there with you?
Yeah, I've got it in front of me.
For for 2014, for instance, for those 325 to 750, there were 6,960 transactions. That's my quick figures I've done myself just in the last few while. I hope I've got that right. And then in 2015, there were 7,890 transactions. So that's two figures coming together, two full years, that suggest to me that between 14 and 15, then the actual numbers of transactions have increased. Have I got that right? Have I got that wrong?
739.
It's different to the numbers that the SPF have got. Yeah.
So we need some clarity around. I'm not saying this is obviously figures you've sourced from somewhere, but it's the same for those over 750, according to the figures we've got from the Registers of Scotland. In 2014, the number was 470, and in 2015, the number was 540. So there's obviously a disparity somewhere between the figures that are available for the Scottish Property Federation and the numbers we've been provided by the Registers of Scotland.
I mean, the numbers are not
that dissimilar.
No,
it could be something like that.
Are the numbers not just January to December and one's April to April?
That's what I think.
So it's one's 2014 and one's 2014/15.
That's what I think. Ah, see, so one's calendar year, one's financial year. Is that what we're saying?
I think so.
Right, we just need to get that clarified afterwards we need to know exactly where we are. Sorry to interrupt, Ivan. I just wanted, sake, I needed to get understand that.
So I think I've made the point. I mean, the argument then comes down to you had expected it to continue to go like that, and it hasn't. Right, and okay, I mean, but certainly in terms of no money has been lost compared to previous years in terms of the change.
The only comment on that, which I've really seen, is the Fiscal Commission's report, where they had a look at forestalling and traded it off, and then looked back at that 325 to 750 band, and it was really the only area that I could see in the Fiscal Commission's outturn report where there was any significant difference between what was expected and what happened in the outturn. So I mean, that's not our data, but it's the only comment on that.
Yeah. But certainly it isn't true to say that there's been a drop-off in transactions. They might not have continued to increase as rapidly as you might have expected, but to say there's been a drop-off in transactions wouldn't be true.
Well, we'd say that they've stalled. I mean, we put in our report a slight dip in the numbers. You might argue that that's the effect of forestalling or otherwise, which there's other analysis of that. So you know, we would say that the market did see a behavioural change within those bands at that time.
Right, and again, for the record, I don't see any evidence for that. Okay.
Anybody else want to comment? Murdo, you come.
Yeah, sorry, I don't take quite the sanguine approach to the figures that my colleague, Mr. McKee, does, because I was looking last night at some fairly detailed breakdowns from Registers of Scotland, looking at the different bands of property over the last seven quarters. Now, you know, it seemed to me, you know, having read your evidence, the most sensitive price bracket is probably the bracket 750 to 1 million. I would have thought, because if you're buying a house over £1 million, the chances are, you know, LBTT is less of an issue, but people who are moving up towards that large family house bracket, that 750 to 1 million is probably the most representative of a sector where if there was going to be a problem generated by high levels of LBTT, it would be demonstrated in that bracket. And if you look at the figures, according to the Registers of Scotland data, just to do some comparative quarters, in the July to September quarter, In 2014, the number of transactions in that bracket was 102. In 2015, in that bracket, the number of transactions was 68. And then if you look at the quarter January to March, number of transactions in 2014 was 73. In 2015 was 104. And in 2016, it dropped to 58. So I think that does rather confirm your proposition that in that bracket, 750 to 1 million, there has been a drop off in transactional activity. Now, whether that's related to LBTT rates is a different issue. And that's what I'm interested in getting your take on. If there has been this drop off in activity in that, you know, upper end of the market, but not the very top end, what is that attributable to? Are there other factors that might be part of that? Or do you think it's mostly down to LBTT rates being high, as your written evidence would suggest?
Well, I would say, as per the previous comment, I think there was a dip in that higher band early. Then I think activity did start up again at that level. However, what I would argue, and I obviously only saw the quarterly breakdown sort of very late on last night, so I think there was a difference of three in one quarter to what we had, but it's not significant. You asked about other factors. I mean, of course, I mean, in those very high value bands, you can't really ignore, I would suggest, the impact in the northeast with the change in the economy up there, and where a lot of houses that probably wouldn't be at those house price bands would be in that market area. So that would have had, I'm sure, an impact on activity. But the market is a continuum, and I think we do make that point in our evidence that changes at high-value bands don't just affect those high-value bands. They will have a consequence, a knock-on effect lower down the property market chain as people aspire to move upwards, or maybe some people in larger houses aspire to move downwards. And so I do think that if the tax thresholds and rates are too lumpy, that they will have a negative impact on that flow of activity.
Okay. Maybe I could ask a similar question to Mr. Gordon, and just to expand on that. I know there's a comment in your written evidence, Mr. Gordon, where you say that RICS have urged the Scottish Government to err on the side of caution when considering a significantly higher tax rate for Scottish properties at the higher end of the house price spectrum. We felt that this would hurt revenue generation through this part of the housing market, as foreign investors would look to invest elsewhere in the UK. Do you feel that concern has been borne out by the evidence?
So I'm representing the RICS and I didn't write the evidence, but so I'm standing in for Hugh. So there's a personal view and there's an RICS view. So my own personal view about the bans is that I'm not sure what parts of Scotland you'd be living in where over 750,000 is a normal family home. So if you simply look at people's average incomes, even double them to 50 or 60,000, multiply that by what you can borrow, you can maybe borrow 250, 300,000, and then have a couple of £100,000 deposit. If you look at people's real lives, anything over 500,000 starts to become really significant price for a property, and you're not really looking at normal people who have normal incomes, to put it in layman's terms. So I'm not that concerned about the sector above 750,000. I think once you get above the rate, the price where you start paying more here and more compared to the old tax and to what you're paying in England, which is around about 300 and something thousand, then I think there's a really serious impact on what happens in the market. So if somebody who could move from a £300,000 house to a £500,000 house, which they can maybe afford with a couple of average incomes and some equity in their properties, then your stamp duty of £30,000 or £20,000 becomes, you know, almost equivalent to one of their salaries. So that's the area of the market that I think the RICS is focused on. So the upper end that we're talking about is not really the £1 million thing, but it all filters down to a degree. So if there are only a few hundred people who can buy the properties above 750,000, you still need people to move up to that sector when they get lucky in life and they can afford that in order to free up the market at the £400,000-£500,000 mark. And there may be some issues around that. And just personally, for me trying to move, you know, from a £400,000 house to £500,000, I do not have the extra stamp duty for that. And that's the situation that I've been if I move. So yeah, I would stop there.
Okay, thank you.
That's been quite a lot of a wide-ranging number of questions, and neither Mark Stevens or Cardin have had a chance to contribute. Before we go on, does anyone want to say at this stage? Yeah.
I've got a couple of observations to make just on the last two questions. The first one relates to the stats. Now, Homes for Scotland themselves don't collect stats on the new build impact, but what I would say is, you know, that there's been debate about the evidence that exists, and the new build contribution to any dip might not be yet showing, so I think that's a good point to make. The feedback we're getting from house builders is they're having to pay the stamp duty. They're obviously in a different position. We're talking about businesses here selling homes as opposed to individual sellers. And to get them over the line to persuade people to buy the homes, they're either having to make up the difference or pay the full bill. So it might, and that's not sustainable, clearly, going forward. So house builders are taking action to remix sites and bring forward smaller properties because they really are listening to the market, and the LBTT is having a really big impact. So any impact from the new build, which as a proportion, obviously, is just a proportion of all sales that take place on an annual basis, but it might be next year, the year after, that you actually see the impact that that's had on the stats. Another point to make, now I'm not going to sit here and claim to be an expert on the stats, that you can drown in the stats that's available on this, and perhaps if you're having another evidence session you would bring in some experts on the stats, because there's a lot out there. What I would say is I understand that there's a difference in the ROS data on date of entry or date of registration, and that might be causing a lag. So if the stats we were looking at earlier are based on registration, some of the transactions actually took place as part of the forestalling in March. It might be showing in the next financial year. So I think that's something to bear in mind if anybody's going to be doing a little bit more work on the stats that have been presented.
We have the Scottish Fiscal Commission coming next week. But before we get them here next week, I've already said to the clerk I want some reconciliation work done on the table provided to us helpfully by the Scottish Federation, Property Federation, compared with the figures that we've got on an annualised basis. I think you're right, Jonathan, to suggest they were annualised. But if you look at, if you take the financial year from these out of the annualised figures, the drop in the number of homes being sold between 325 and 750 was only actually 65 between 14 and 15. Quick reconciliation of the figures. So what we need to do before we get to next week is make sure we've got that information tightened up and we know exactly what's happening, because that does seem to be the case. It's just there's been a small drop off, not the really big hit, I'm afraid, Karen, that you're suggesting. But we need to make double sure that these figures are right. Jonathan, you wanted to say something.
Could that 375 to 750 figure be broken down into £100,000 bands or something? Because there's such a marked difference between 20,000 and 60,000, you know, in terms of stamp duty you pay within that band. So could that be done as well? And
we'll ask for
the committee to look at it.
If that provides us with more clarity. Ash, you wanted to come in.
Yes. Professor Mark Stevens, in your submission, you say LBTT should be allowed to settle. And then in the RICS submission, there was quite a bit throughout that submission on these sort of key strands of stability and consistency. So the RICS recommendation to the Scottish Government is not to allow the bands and thresholds to be changed until the results of the research report are out. And just for the record, the research report is called Evidence Review Tax Forecasting Models for the Housing Market. So I'm just wondering, is it the panel's view that the market will adapt and settle, or indeed maybe it already has?
Professor?
I think it's simply too soon to know. I mean, if I might encourage you to step back a little from the relatively short period that we've been examining in great detail, and think about the way in which the housing market operates and the way in which this tax and its predecessors have operated. And we know the housing market is very volatile. It's not just driven by
incomes, numbers of households, and so on. It's also an asset market, so it's driven by expectations of changes in capital values and so on. And as a consequence, it is a volatile market. Prices are volatile, and transactions are even more volatile. And in my paper, you'll see a number of graphs which indicate quite how volatile revenues from stamp duty and its successors have been. Having said that, we would expect transaction taxes to have an effect on the market. We know from experience of changing these transaction taxes that the changes can have an effect on behaviour, and we know that anticipated changes in taxes can influence behaviour, which incidentally is another reason why I think it would be sensible to dampen speculation about changing the bans in the short term. But there's a further effect, which is concerning any short-term disruption to the market. It may be that prices in these higher ranges haven't responded yet, or haven't responded fully to the impact of an increased average tax burden. We would expect over time the effect of a higher average tax, transaction tax, to have a downward pressure on prices. But we know through housing market cycles that when there is a reduction in demand, homeowners who are trying to sell, anticipating selling their properties, are reluctant to lower the price. They know how much it was worth a few years ago, or when they bought it, or at the peak, and they're reluctant to accept that it doesn't have an intrinsic value, that the value can fall. And for those reasons, amongst others, I think it's too soon to say whether the impact has followed through completely. My intuitive feeling is that it hasn't, and therefore it would be sensible to examine the longer term impact of the new regime.
You also have a view on that as well. Karen?
I certainly do. This is specific to the new build industry, and we're taking action now in response to this. So anybody that's got sites that have got current planning permission that aren't selling, they're actually taking them back to the planning and remixing. Or any sites coming forward, they're more likely to change their plans and more likely to be building smaller homes. So that will have an effect on future revenue projections for those values. I should say as well, no one likes certainty more than a house builder, given the amount of risk over the number of years it takes to bring a development forward. So this is all adding to it. So I was intrigued by the comments were made about, hold on, let's wait. But I think the markets are suffering to such an extent, particularly in the northeast, which might be for other reasons. But we do have a lever here that we could use to stimulate the market. And I would suggest that if we don't seem to have come to a conclusion as to the financial impact in terms of revenue on the impact over the last year. But if once you've heard from Fiscal Commission and you come to a conclusion on that, it's already showing that you're not achieving the income that you wanted to for Scotland. And hearing feedback from property professionals, and I would suggest action is required now. From our point of view, we've got businesses that are really suffering out there. Those bigger businesses that are operating in this space can change the mix, and they can, they've eggs in more baskets, if you like. Smaller businesses, who are, for example, building family homes in St Andrews or up in the northeast, they're really struggling. We're seeing sites mothballed for the first time since the recession. That's a serious concern to us. So, to stimulate the market, we would suggest we can't wait any longer to recorrect that or reapportion that section, which is for us the 325 to the 750, or to mirror SDLT in England to keep us attractive to investment, take it up to the 925. Okay.
Jonathan, David, do you want to reflect on that as well?
I think I just always try and draw it back to real life examples. So the Homes for Scotland submission had a couple of examples of what I would class as kind of aspirational family homes in good areas. And if you just look at the tax that's written on that, just how that impacts on individual people who are trying to buy those houses, there's the majority of the market of people buying homes is people buying and selling houses, and certainly in Edinburgh where I work, you know, it's resale market in Edinburgh. So there are not enough homes in the areas where people want to live, in the key cities in Edinburgh and Glasgow and others. And the market may adjust, but it might not adjust the way that you want it to if you want a progressive situation. So the lower tax rate or the zero tax rate at the lower end has increased, may have increased the number of transactions in that. It's also increased the demand. So over the last couple of years, the demand has come back in where people are, there are 20 people bidding for one pokey flat, I would call it, in Dalry, but pokey in the terms of it's nearly £200,000 for a small two-bedroom flat where they've converted it from a one-bed. So it's only got a pokey kitchen in the middle. So it is a pokey kitchen. So the 20 people bidding for that, when it's valued at 140 or 150,000, it's going up towards £200,000 in terms of purchase price. So that's not really helping those people. They're putting them into more debt. Yes, they're not paying £1,000 of stamp duty now, but they're actually going into more debt because borrowing restrictions have been lifted a little bit and they can borrow more money and they can afford to buy that now. So I don't think it's necessarily the market changes that you want that are going to settle into it. If you're not building the family homes, which are the easiest ones to build when the market is slow and difficult, which are the ones that are highlighted in here and the ones up to that level, homes are much easier to build and plan for than flats because you can build them as you sell them. And if those are the ones that Homes for Scotland are saying are not selling because of this tax, then that's going to feed through to people not moving out of the flats, less supply for people at the lower end, and continued pressures on demand and supply pushing prices up.
Just a small comment just to add to that. I agree absolutely with Karen about the need to see tax as also an instrument to try and stimulate growth and that. And as I said previously, we do see the issue of the market being one as a continuum. And so for the reasons which Jonathan's just explained very well, I just make, I suppose, the specific point on changing rates and thresholds, which was made. I suppose I'd view the evidence we submitted as almost being a fairly minimal change in a way of changing the 5% threshold upwards to around £500,000. More tweaking, really, rather than significant change. But I nonetheless think it could be very important to help stimulate activity in that particular banding of the residential market.
I think you would come back in.
Yes, I did, if I may. I think this we have some disagreement here, in that you know, this question. The key point is that if you want to sell a house and you can't at the price that you're charging, maybe because the rate of transaction tax has increased on it, then the market response over time will be for the value of that property to fall. And so you can't just say in a dynamic market that the price of houses is fixed. It's not, and they will respond. And it's important to recognise that although the purchaser legally pays the tax, we would expect, in effect, over time, more of that burden to be actually borne by the seller in terms of reflecting the price.
Well, Jonathan.
Well, I would like to come back on that as well. I mean, I do take that point and understand that point. But if we're going to stop increasing the supply of homes in that space, then the market's going to be distorted. There's going to be pent-up demand and more people bidding for the existing homes that are in that space. And that's where, you know, the seller, it'll be a seller's market. And, you know, they're unlikely to reduce the price to take into account the LBTT.
So in the areas where people want to live, there is not enough supply. And if there are five or six people bidding for a house at £500,000, it is the people that cannot afford the tax that will pull out of that market and not bid for the house. And the people who can afford it, who are wealthy or who have higher incomes, who will purchase a property at the same price, rather than the price dropping, would be my estimation of what would happen in the short to medium term. But that's as a chartered surveyor. So if in a perfect world where there was some kind of equilibrium between supply and demand, which there is not, which is why there's a housing crisis, then what the professor says is correct. But I would argue that we don't have anywhere near a perfect market in housing for many reasons. And therefore, that is the unprogressive nature of this tax overall in the way that it's structured, or in the tax in itself, regardless of how it's structured.
Ash, did you want any supplementary to that?
Well, I was just going to say that when I understand progressive in taxation, I understand that the people, in this case for residential housing, in the lower property prices pay less, and the people in the higher property prices pay more because they're able to. So my understanding is this is a progressive tax.
So when I think of progression, I think about incomes and your ability to live on what you're earning. And so two people bidding for a £500,000 house, one person could be earning £100,000 a year and one person earning £50,000 a year. And so if the person who is earning £50,000 a year cannot afford to buy that house because they haven't got the tax, then it's an unprogressive tax because only the wealthier person can afford it.
Hmm. I suppose the spirit of the legislation...
House.
No, I take that point. I do take that point. But I suppose the spirit of the legislation is to allow more people to pay less tax at the lower end. And I suppose that's the idea of the spirit of the legislation.
The spirit of the legislation was correct and admirable. But the outcome, I think, I'm only so my anecdotal evidence is based on Edinburgh in the key areas, city centre, and prices are shooting up for the first time by 10%, 20% in some areas. Mm. And that's, you know, sometimes 10% in spring and then 10% again in autumn over the last year and a half. Mm. And so that's unsustainable in terms of affordability for the people that are buying those properties. And that has, so the progressive nature of the design of the tax has created that situation where first time buyers are having to get further into debt and pay more for their houses, even though they're paying less tax.
Wanted in. I think we'll try and move on from this area after Mark's contributed. So.
Yes.
Is that a supplementary?
Well, the question of progressivity is one that has been visited, for example, with council tax reform as well. The academic view would be that how progressive a tax is measured against the tax base. And in this case, the tax base is property values. So in that sense, this tax is unambiguously progressive. But we also know from the consultations on the council tax reform is that the public's perception of progressiveness or fairness also strongly relates to their current income. And one thing we don't know very clearly is how closely related taxes to people's actual monetary incomes, and that's a view for you really as to what importance you attach to the two.
I think Willie's got a supplementary in this area, and then I'm going to bring in Alec Johnston on regional variation issues.
Thanks very much, convener. It's just to pick up on this issue about the impact and the high value. Properties, notwithstanding the discussion we had a wee minute ago, the data we have for Registers of Scotland suggests that the high-value properties are performing pretty well, and we can haggle about the calendar or the financial year aspect of it, but it looks as though it's performing pretty well when you compare it to the other band thresholds. But this morning I had a look at the David Wilson website where these houses that you've provided these examples. And that particular house that you're showing there on page one of your submission, that's actually on one of the websites this morning at a higher price than you've shown us there. It says it's worth £474,000 on this sheet, but when I looked at it this morning, convener, it's actually down at £479,000. So I'm curious about whether there is an impact here and whether there's been any action taken to try and reduce the prices or something like that. But in looking at other evidence from this particular street, convener, there's been some recent sales in that street, and only last October There was one for £360,000 and it's now valued at £380,000. So the point I'm making with this convener is that the value in that particular house there now exceeds the cost of the LBT tax that might have been applied to it. So there's another side to this coin, that these are very high value properties, and in a matter, a small matter of a year, the value of that property is exceeding, in some cases by far, the impact that the LBTT might have had on it. So do you take that into account when you know the business is promoting and marketing these properties, that they are high value, and within a short space of time they'll appreciate in value much, much more than the other bands may do?
Can, yeah.
I find it really interesting you've looked at the websites. Welcome your interest there. In terms of the different products, it could be, you know, it could be a different plot, a more attractive plot, a sunnier garden. Lots of things affect the value of the range. These were picked at complete random. I thought the Fairmount Head site was an interesting one because, you know, when you look at the home, it's a family home. There's nothing hugely, no offence, David Wilson, nothing hugely luxurious about it. It's a family product, yet they've got to pay. Well, unfortunately, that's what you have to pay for a family product in Edinburgh. And it's certainly not the house builder that sets the values there, it's the market. But a tax bill of £20,000, and knowing, because these buyers at this level are intelligent, so they'll know, they'll be able to run the calculations of what that would have cost them, you know, a couple of years ago, or how that compares to what people are paying in England.
In a year's time, though, the value of that house will far exceed the price they've paid on the LBT tax.
It may.
Well, the evidence suggests that it does.
So it has for the sale that you've identified there, which is good news for that buyer, but it doesn't always happen that way. And what I would say is it's the cash flow issue. It's a cash burden on these buyers. These family buyers are looking to move to a new home and having to find £20,000 to make that move in cash. That's where the issue lies here. They might be getting a capital increase further down the line. Whether that's ever realised or not is a different story, but it's the cash impact.
It's a good return to look forward to in less than a year, where the new value of your house has exceeded the tax.
It's not real money, though.
Well, I know. Well, no, it's not real money.
No. So I think. So okay. I didn't get into the market quick enough when I was younger. But I think, you know, there are people that bought flats for £50,000 within my lifetime, and they've doubled in value. Then they've managed to buy some, so they sold it for 100, then they bought something for 125 and it doubled in value over 5-10 years. So the market, that's not a great market to me, but the reality of the situation is that the majority of people who are purchasing or trying to purchase £400,000-£500,000 houses in and around Edinburgh, and I guess in and around Glasgow, are people who have built up in this housing ladder that everybody talks about, and they do not have £20,000 in cash, and they're overstretching themselves in their mortgage to get a house that they need for their family. So you've got to draw it back to real situations and think about cash. So just because a house goes up in value and you have that asset sitting there, you can't do anything with it unless you sell again, and then you'd have to pay even more stamp duty, which you don't have.
Mark, and then we'll move on.
Thank you. I'm just puzzled by this this idea that one can assert that house prices are set by the market, and then if you've built a house, you put a price on it, no one will buy it. Then the only response is is that the price that you're asking for is higher than the market value. And the only way you'll sell it is by reducing the price. I think there is a fundamental question about how house prices or how actors in the market are responding. I think we should expect at times for house builders also to respond to what the market's telling them.
Okay, I want to move on to regional variation issues now, and Alec Johnston.
Okay, thank you very much, convener. We've touched on the issue of regional variation, but I come from the northeast, and looking at the figures, the tipping point where the tax payable goes higher than the rest of the UK is about £330,000, and you don't get much for £330,000 within 15 miles of Aberdeen city centre. The result is that the market is now, in my view, being damaged. What do you think is happening to the marketplace in places like Aberdeen, where the tax really is biting?
New build point of view, it's absolutely damaged up there. Perhaps not just due to LBTT, but as I outlined before, this is a lever that is within the Scottish Government's control. The fact that sites are being mothballed, I think, is terrifying. So builders are taking the properties to wind and watertight, and they can't afford to take them any further because the market's not there. Or where they've not yet started build, they're trying to remix and bring forward. So the industry, the new build industry, is reacting as fast as it can to the market. With the planning process that we have across Scotland, I mean, that could take a number of years, unfortunately. So it's a slow reaction that's going to take place to bring forward cheaper properties, perhaps to target a different market in the area. But right now, the North East is really struggling and could do with some stimulation in the market.
Can I ask? Can I ask, just in terms of there's obviously anecdotal evidence and there's real evidence of what's just happening in the market overall, and you've touched on yourself. This could be down to economic matters, it could be down to financial issues, demographic issues in the North East as well. Has any real work been done to get underneath what the real issues are in there? Because we had evidence from Aberdeen City Council, for instance, who said that they couldn't really put a finger on one specific issue that was causing the downturn in the North East. So if Homes for Scotland got any real evidence that is that issue, it would be useful to know that, or anybody else.
Unfortunately, no, it's not something we're resourced to collect in terms of that granular data. I don't know whether the City Commerce or anybody like that, the Chamber of Commerce, has any information. Unfortunately, I don't know.
Okay, has anybody else got any?
We have local authority level breakdowns by price bands, which are tagged to the WTT rates, which was the basis of what we've put in over the period of time. But again, that is only really quite high level quantitative data. But certainly by local authority level, Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire, we do have and we could provide, yes.
We can see the slowdown and we can see the issues there, but what we don't know is what the evidence for causing that is. That's the point I'm trying to make in real terms.
I mean, you can't disengage the causality of it, obviously, from what's happened in the economy, in the area. I mean, I think the figures from yesterday, 100,000 jobs in that industry is doing so well. I mean, that's obviously going to impact on people's ability to pay, so...
You got any more? Alex, sorry, I interrupted you.
I was going to ask about the, not necessarily just in the Aberdeen area, because I know there's Edinburgh and pockets of Glasgow where the same problem exists. The effect is that a tax that effectively is one size fits all across the whole of the country is impacting disproportionately on areas of higher house price. That distortion, how does that play out across the rest of the housing market? Is it causing people to travel further to work? Are there socio-economic problems being caused by this?
That's not something we have any evidence on at this stage. And as I said, the true impact on new builds isn't yet felt because the builders are acting, you know, they're unfortunately having to foot the bill to make up the difference for the stock that they're selling now, and that's not going to happen going forward. So we don't know the impact, the wider impact yet. We don't even have anything on an anecdotal basis, actually, on that.
You've mentioned a couple of times the idea, or suggested the idea, that builders may in some cases be absorbing the cost of the additional tax. Certainly my experience is that builders who are building houses that are significantly higher tax liabilities are saying that they simply cannot do that. That's too high a proportion of the cost of the building. The effect appears to be that, as I've observed in the North East, agrees with what you're saying, that sites are showing very low levels of activity. There is mothballing going on. And that's in an area where there's still an identifiable house shortage. Is that How does that impact on communities with the housing shortage, but the builders won't build?
I'd imagine it's going to have a massive impact. I mean, we know the position across Scotland. We're not building nearly enough homes, and that's having an impact on a national basis. You will see it harder in some communities where people want to live, where the demand far outstrips the supply available. I should clarify my point that builders who have got the home to a certain stage where they have to, you know, they have to move off that site, stock properties, that's where the sales will be incentivised, as opposed to those that are just, you know, coming out the ground, where they can stop building and until that home sales, they won't complete the build. So that's the sort of distinguishing difference there. So they are incentivising where they have to, you know, where they're desperate to get the return back and the cash that they've invested in the property.
And the relationship between the market in the long term and the market as it currently exists was suggested by Professor Stevens earlier, that if a house is built and it can't be sold for what the builder wants for it, then it has to be sold for a lower price. That may work on an individual, the basis of an individual house, but what it means is that ultimately the houses simply will not be built, is it?
Exactly, yes. Or if it's going to be a long-term trend over the next 5 years or something, we could then start incorporating a lower house price into the land values. But at the minute, you know, most of the homes that are coming forward is land that's already purchased, the price is already agreed based on market values.
Mark, respond to that, given that you quoted him.
Yes, that we have an agreement. It's not that the houses won't be built, it will be then over time that the land values should go down. And so you then end up with a lower market price. But this question of housing supply, of course, is very important. And I don't want to diminish the possibility that a transaction tax is distorting, and it might be, to a degree that is undesirable. We don't know yet, but I think it would be a very big leap to suggest that this is a major factor in the overall supply question of housing. There are far more important factors going on with which I think we're all familiar.
Okay, Marie, we come to you, I think.
Hi there. I've got a particular question for you, Karen. I see in your submission you about additional home supplement. You say that you continue to believe that the purchase of new build properties for buy-to-let purposes or as second homes represents additional activity which does not crowd out the purchase of homes by first-time buyers. I would ask you how you know that, or where the evidence is for that. I would imagine that it would, in reality, affect the house price in these areas for second homes. And I have to say, I represent the Highlands and Islands, so... to give you a little bit of background, that's a huge... There's a lot of second home buying in the area that I represent. There are communities which are becoming quite seriously unbalanced, because 50 to 60% of the housing stock is owned by second home, are second homes. So I'd be interested to know where you have the evidence for this.
I mean, our intelligence is very much based on discussions with home builders. Exactly, yes. Activity by investors can actually help the supply for first-time buyers. I'll give you an example of that, and that's bringing forward flatted developments. To bring forward an apartment size building is a huge investment and a huge risk for a builder. Quite often what happens is they'll sell off plan to investors a number of plots, which gives them the cash flow and the confidence to take that forward and deliver it. Now, I already know that this is having an impact on the number of plans to bring forward flatted developments, because they're not confident that they're going to have that upfront investment and confidence that they require to deliver the full development. And I think that's significant. We definitely do see new build as different in terms of the additional home supplement. Rural locations as well. Feedback we've had from builders suggests, you know, the product they're delivering in some rural locations that you're from, they're not targeted at a first-time buyer market. They are very much a luxurious holiday home for somebody who can afford it, which, you know, having these people invest in your communities can really stimulate the local economy. And there's a fear that...
Where's the evidence for that? So if you live in a community of a couple of hundred people and half of the houses are owned by people who don't live there, it does put a real strain on the local school, on you know, on the local, how the community runs. So I would ask you again, where's the evidence for that?
Our intelligence is from member feedback. We don't actually collect any data on that, unfortunately. We're not resourced to.
I'd just add another point I think the good point Karen's made, which is that the issue as well is about your SME house builders who might get going, or your property entrepreneurs. The additional tax at that level can have a negative influence on your ability to actually go ahead, your development, appraisal and so forth. And the truth is that the SME house building industry was hit very, very severely in the recession, which we had 10 years ago, 9 or 10 years ago, and has not really recovered. And so I'd just add to the point made that I think it can have a negative impact on those people who are trying to get going on house building that's below the six property threshold. And cumulatively, that can actually add up to quite a lot of supply, and did so before the 2008 recession.
I think there is obviously a problem in the Highland Islands, and I wouldn't argue against that. When you focus in on new builds, though, so most of the big house builders, and unfortunately it is becoming more and more limited to big house builders who are able to plan for particularly things like changes to tax rates, they're planning ahead and they own bits of land already. So where people are building flats in particular, as Karen said, the builder will own a bit of land for a few years, trying to plan ahead, or land banking. Some people would argue that that's not a good thing, but generally they're trying to plan ahead so that they can build enough homes to keep the company going and growing. And they don't sell all the homes in one go, so they build the flats block by block as they sell them. It's common sense that if 50% of them are sold to investors, then without that 50%, they're going to build those flats more slowly. And they're going to be less able to commit to starting that block of flats. So I'm absolutely convinced that the additional supplement is restricting some investment in buy-to-let properties, but will be slowing down the rate of planning for building blocks of flats in key areas like Edinburgh and Glasgow where they're needed. And it's not just anecdotal, so it's factual evidence based on the number of properties that we take on from new investors as a company in Edinburgh.
Okay. I wonder if anyone else on the panel has any thoughts on the rural situation and on the question of whether the additional dwelling supplement makes a difference to the second home ownership, if there is any evidence out there. I was just struck that your submission viewed it as entirely a positive thing.
Mark, you want to make any comment? I'm not forcing you to, but feel free if you wish to.
I don't have the evidence to suggest.
Sorry, Mark, on you go.
But I think it, you know, again, I put it in context. I think the you have a special problem in housing markets where purchases or a significant number of purchases are coming from another area where incomes may be much higher. So I suppose you get it in London with international investors, and clearly you get it in the Highlands and Islands. So what role, you know, how significant a 3% surcharge is, I don't know. I mean, I would guess only at the margin.
Any other questions? Any others want to go in? Marie, are you?
No, I think that's it. I did have another question about broadening the range of the band, but I think we covered it adequately.
Okay. Murdo, I think you had a supplementary.
Yeah, just a follow-up on Marie Todd's questions on additional dwelling supplement. I noticed in the Homes for Scotland submission, this is to Karen Campbell initially, that there's talk about the introduction of exemptions to help prevent the unintended impacts of additional home supplement. Do you want to just say a little bit more about what you're referring to there and what exemptions you would like to see? I think RICS makes similar comments, Mr. Gordon, in their submission.
I think this comes down to the speed in which it was introduced as a new form of revenue. And I can understand that was to mirror the change made down south. But I think, you know, we've got a period behind us now where we're starting to experience what some of the unintended consequences are, and perhaps a lot more detailed work needs to go down into looking at that. I mean, we very, very much welcomed the exemption for the bulk purchases because we are determined to grow strategically the build to rent sector in Scotland, and that at the minute gives us a huge advantage over England, which is, you know, to try and encourage investment is very much to be welcomed. Having said that, from speaking to colleagues in our equivalent organisation down south, I think there's a lot of noise about changes that are to be expected in the SDLT system coming, I think it'll be the budget this year. One of the things they're looking at as well is not just looking at the bulk purchases over six units, but, you know, what that landlord has already in their folio, if they're adding to that, which might assist. There's a lot of regulation going on at the minute which very much supports the sort of large scale professional landlord. But, you know, the small-scale landlords play an important part as well in terms of housing supply, and I don't think we should forget that. So we might need to look at some flexibility to there. Things like parents buying a property for their child to use while they're studying or at the early stages of their career. Again, that's a quite regular purchase, particularly for flatted developments in cities where we have universities. That's going to stop, so that might have further pressure on other properties in that area. That perhaps needs to be looked at. The rural dimension probably needs to be looked at with a little bit more evidence, as Marie points out. The cash flow issue on those that are end up at unintended second homeowners, I think needs to be looked at as well, because that can have a really strong impact. I don't think a lot of the public are aware that this exists as well. So, you know, when they're planning, particularly downsizers as well, who maybe want to buy a retirement home before committing to sell, they won't want the disruption of having to sell and then quickly find something new. They might find themselves with two homes, and, you know, we want to encourage a mobility in that area, so that's perhaps an exemption that should be looked at. There's a number, and I think it needs a lot more detailed thought now that we do have experience of it.
I think James wanted to come in on this as well.
Sure. Take the points you make, and I know Jonathan made similar specific points in his submission. Some would argue that, you know, by building in exemptions like that, you reduce the fees and therefore you potentially reduce the amount of money raised by this tax that contributes towards the Scottish budget. How would you counter that?
I don't have the answer to that, I'm afraid, James. I appreciate that you need to be thinking about, particularly this committee, the revenue stream, but that needs to be looked at in closer detail, I think, than just an off-the-cuff comment from me today.
Jonathan, do you...?
Yeah, I think it's a difficult consideration, which is why it shouldn't be taken quickly. But I think that's an argument, to allow it to bed in a bit as a tax before making substantial changes, which I think is what the RICS suggests. I guess just in terms of exemptions, though, one of the original exemptions, which was actually I put into the original RICS consultation response when it was introduced, the additional dwelling supplement, was just exempting new build properties, but that could be targeted at specific areas or specific types of properties, because there is an issue about building blocks of flats where investors are not, you know, the builders will build more and more, and yes, prices might rise if the demand's a little bit there, but you need to investigate the evidence for that. I haven't seen any investigation of that specific potential exemption, because that stimulation to the market and the loss of the tax, you know, that there's a good chance that the stimulation of the economy would more than offset the loss in tax revenue in terms of a benefit for the government or the country.
Actually, that just leads in nicely, I think, into Neil, because you were interested in first-time buyer issues as well, Neil, weren't you? So.
Yeah, I was keen to ask, obviously there's been a lot of discussion about the impact on the higher end of the market, but I just wanted to ask your thoughts on the impact on first-time buyers. We've received evidence, I think it was your move, have said that the number of first-time buyers, property sales has increased in Scotland higher than in the UK. And also not 9,700 prospective owner-occupiers that benefited from the policy of setting the nil rate LBTT threshold 20,000 higher than for the UK. Just wanted to ask for your thoughts on how it's impacted on first-time buyers and what you see happening in the future.
Seems to be ladies first a lot, thank you. I mean, as much as the focus of the discussion has been on the distortion at the higher end, we mustn't forget how good a thing it has been for first-time buyers, and some of the stats on that are to be absolutely welcomed and celebrated in terms of the reduced tax take for the majority of the people in Scotland. However, discussions that our people on the front line, the salespeople, are having with first-time buyers, I don't think it's really even coming into their consciousness that they're saving money. They won't be familiar with the old system. They just aren't aware of the tax. Quite often people aren't aware of this tax until they go to buy a home. So it's not influencing the buying decision at that level. So it's absolutely to be welcomed. We should do all that we can to support first-time buyers. They are the lifeblood of the housing market. But it's not an influencing decision. There's more powerful factors such as the supply of available of the right kind of property, and mortgage availability is absolutely key. So it's potentially the mortgage market that's really pushed this part of the sector because it has been much easier to access a mortgage over the last couple of years. That doesn't explain the Scottish differential there, which I don't have any intelligence on.
And they also want to reflect on that?
I'm not sure what benefit it is for a first-time buyer if they're saving £1,000 in tax and having to spend £10,000 or £20,000 or £30,000 extra on the property because of the increasing demand and the increasing price of the properties. So the market's been changing a lot as we recover from 2008 and 2009, so it's hard to attribute the tax as being a causal effect on anything within the market. But the market that I'm looking at in Edinburgh, where first-time buyers are buying properties, there is more competition and they're paying higher prices for them, so they're having more debt. So they're more able to buy it because they have enough cash to buy it, because they don't have to pay the tax, but they're putting themselves further into debt for a higher house price. So overall, I think it's been a good thing, is the RICS view, but I just think more research needs to be done on what position these first-time buyers are now in terms of their debt levels and the price of the property they paid.
This is a very interesting area here, because some of the evidence that we had a couple of weeks ago was showing quite clearly that the market for first-time buyers at the lower end in Scotland was increasing significantly quicker than the market south of the border was concerned. So if the economic conditions are similar and we've got a situation where they're across the whole of the UK where there's a shortage of housing building, which seems to be the situation, and yet south of the border we've got a picture for first-time buyers that's, in terms of the number of transactions that are going, that's significantly lower than Scotland, there's obviously something going on. So what's the difference, and what is the issue if it's not the fact that they're not paying any tax? Has anybody got an answer to that? No? Okay, fair enough. It just seems to me there's an obvious relationship between the tax not existing for first-time buyers, because it's a comparator with the south of the border.
Higher.
In Scotland?
In England.
No, I realise.
So it's a different base level. It's not comparable, I don't think. I mean...
Okay, fair enough. Adam.
It's my role this morning, I think, to play sweeper and...
Apologise. I think Neil had a supplementary and I got in his way, so do forgive me.
Question on Revenue Scotland.
So forgive me, Adam.
Sorry, I've just had a question I wanted to ask about Revenue Scotland.
My fault.
As well. The Scottish Property Federation have said we are not aware as yet of any plans for the introduction of the 3-year non-residential lease reassessments. and we are concerned this could prove to be a significant administrative challenge to Revenue Scotland. I just wanted to ask generally how you think Revenue Scotland have been handling the new tax. Do you think they are adequately resourced to do the job?
Okay, well, we think RS have bedded the tax in well, broadly. I think we say that. Our committee has not reported too many issues with it, apart from a couple of, I think they are more concerned on the commercial side than as opposed to the residential side, if I'm honest, where you get very complex transactions where it's not always clear on how the lawyer should implement their end of the administration of the tax. And that's probably the only area where some anecdotal concerns have been raised about it takes a lot longer to sometimes get an answer on technical questions or to get an answer at all from Revenue Scotland as compared to HMRC, who obviously have a lot more experience with SDLT, to be fair. So that is the only concern there. The point you raised there is the legislation will require taxpayers to reassess the rents that they paid the lease duty on every 3 years. There used to be a similar type system in under SDLT, but it was only every 5 years. In truth, it was a regulation that was not really implemented as such by either market or, I'd argue, HMRC. So our question is, we simply don't know at this stage how it's going to work. And I just put to you, if you're a business, you've taken on a 10-year lease, you pay your lease tax up front as soon as you take that property on lease. 3 years down the line, as far as if you read the legislation, suggestion is that you reassess and you go to Revenue Scotland and tell them whether the rent has changed or not. And I'm just a bit dubious at this stage that there don't seem to be any plans as to how that's actually going to work in administrative practice. I mean, there are thousands of lease events every year in Scotland, and I just don't think a business is going to recollect 2.5 years into its tenancy that it's now got a statutory requirement to reassess its rent and get back in touch with Revenue Scotland, having paid its tax 3 years beforehand. So it's a heads up marker, Mr. Bibby, really, that I think there's an issue there that needs to be addressed on an admin point.
Jonathan, you want to reflect on that issue? No. Adam, again, apologies for interrupting you. It was rude of me, but
no,
I don't notice Neil.
No problem. I think it's my job, convenience, to play sweeper today, and I'll ask you a couple of questions that haven't really come up, although one of my questions does relate to what Neil's just been asking you about. So perhaps we can start there. One of the things that we are concerned with as a committee is looking forward to the next few years. We're going to see more and more fiscal devolution coming to the Scottish Parliament. Land taxes, including LBTT, have been in the vanguard of that fiscal devolution. And so I wondered if you had any reflections that you wanted to share with us about the way in which the administrative structures of LBTT are working, whether there are things that we should guard against repeating in the design of future taxes, or things that have been quite good practice that we should seek to encourage. Particularly, I was thinking in terms of the relationship between Revenue Scotland and the Scottish ministers, or in the relationship between Revenue Scotland and HMRC.
Okay. David?
Perhaps just an addition, actually, to the answer I've just given. I mean, we are aware that sometimes members are saying that some of the questions that they might put to Revenue Scotland, there'll be uncertainty at the RS level as to whether that's for them or Scottish Government in a policy term. So I think there's just a bit of, and in England you don't really have the same problem because it's HMRC. So I think there's some issues around interpretation of legislation and administering. I'll give you an example. I'll have to write to you on that. But it was just a broad reflection that's been felt by members. But again, I'd have to caveat it that obviously HMRC have a lot longer experience of the mechanics of SDLT in legislation. So broadly speaking, I think the tax has bedded in well on the whole, in administrative terms.
Anybody else want to reflect on that? Well, David, useful actually if you could write with some examples, if you could write to the committee on that, as Adam's asked, I think that would be quite. You've suggested that would be quite helpful.
Just one other. I mean, again, this might be a question that this panel doesn't want to answer or can't answer, which would be fine. But in the previous evidence that we took in this inquiry, which I think was 2 weeks ago, we heard in particular from the Law Society of Scotland that there was a concern that, as the witness put it, we tax by statute and we untax by extra statutory concession. And so this is a question about whether LBTT is too complex, and if it is too complex, whether that complexity is adequately or fairly reflected on the face of the statute book, or whether it's sort of hidden in these rather curious extra statutory concessions, which may be relating to what you've just said, David, about Revenue Scotland's struggle always to answer questions on the operation of the tax, because those operational questions run into policy questions quite quickly. So is that a concern that you've come up against in any of your professional dealings with this tax so far?
In short answer, yes, it is a complicated tax. It's a complicated transactional system that we have. I think the intention of the bill, the act as it became, was to try and keep it as simple as possible. But inevitably, there was, I think, quite a lot of bleed through, as it were, from the existing stamp duty land tax provisions, which didn't always chime well with LBTT. So I think it would be fair to say that the complexity isn't wholly represented on the face of the act as we have it now. I think that's fair to say.
Yeah. And does that cause you professional problems in practice, or is it just a, as it were, academic problem?
I think for most transactions, if you took a whole number, I think this is probably more on the non-domestic side of matters, I would suggest. And yes, that does lead to complications. And of course, it leads to complications. There's a lot of investors who were used to having policy on a UK-wide level, and that's still feeding through into how we administer the new tax at this stage. But it is probably quite specific and technical commercial transactions we're talking about. I don't think it's been such an issue on the residential side.
Okay, anybody else want to reflect on that? Are you okay? Well, thank you very much, panel members, for coming along and giving us some evidence. I think, as we said at the beginning, we need to do some reconciliation work on the figures, and we'll do that. And once we have that these figures reconciled, either by the Register of Scotland or Revenue Scotland, we'll share them with you as well, so you've got that same basis of information. But again, thank you very much for coming along this morning. The next meeting of the committee will be on Wednesday, the 5th of October, when we'll continue to take evidence in the same area. As we have only one piece of business in public today on our agenda, I now suspend the meeting and we move into private session.